On behalf of all of us at Sunset Church of Christ, I want to welcome you to our Sunday morning worship service. If you have a question about Sunset or about this service, drop us a comment and one of our staff will gladly get back with you. For prayer requests, you can call us or you can shoot us an email at office@sunsetchurchofchrist.org. For giving options, you can click the link in the description directly below this video. There you will also find other useful links like our online bulletin, as well as the option to jump directly to today's message. Lastly, thank you for joining us to worship God today and to dig into His Word. Let's begin.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship today. It feels good saying that. And we are so glad that you have made us a part of your day today. I know we're a little bit out of practice, but thank you so much for coming today. After many weeks of, why am I keeping my mask on? That's crazy. I had it on for so long, I guess I forgot that it was on. Man. After many weeks of worshiping apart online and not being able to be together, today really is a special day, and we are just so thankful again that you have decided to come today. Obviously, today's service looks just a little bit different, and we apologize for that. We're trying to stay within regulations, but we know the excitement and joy that we all share together by being here today certainly outweighs any of the awkwardness or the inconveniences and things like that. In preparation for your arrival today, our youth group came here a couple days ago and spent really a considerable amount of time painting and trimming and just sprucing things up so that you could be encouraged, as encouraged as possible to return. So a huge thank you to them for doing that. They worked really hard, and here are some before and after pictures that you can look at. Oh, speaking of worshiping online for a long time, I thought that I could make you feel a little bit more at home by setting this up here. So some of you have seen our online videos, and Dwight and I have put this sign in our background several places, and a lot of you picked up on that, so that was a little Easter egg that you could find there. As we begin our time of worship today, I wanted us to just listen to a portion of a psalm together where the psalmist praises the Lord, and he says, "Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into His presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to Him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods." I don't know about you, but I was getting a little tired singing to myself at the TV. So as we are here together this morning, let's make a joyful noise to the Lord together and sing to Him and worship together with all of our hearts. Let's begin with a prayer.
It is good to be back. I think it's appropriate that we begin by going to our Father. So let's pray together. Father, we are so thankful and we're so grateful that we have an opportunity now to come back into this building, Father, and to worship together in more of a corporate environment, Father. And not that we haven't been worshiping you all along, but Father, we're so thankful and grateful that we've been given this opportunity to come back together. Father, we're so thankful for you and for our Lord Jesus, that you stood by us during this time, Father, and that you continue to stand with us. Father, so many things that we are grateful for, and that we praise you, Father, that you've given our hearts courage. You've given our hearts the compassion for others. And Father, help us to continue to reach into the lives of those that are around us and those in our community so that they can see the loving touch of you through us. Father, we always pause in these times to remember those that are ill, that are suffering, Father, with different various diseases, Father. And we have so many that suffer from just general diseases that we all have from time to time, and we ask that you give them comfort. Father, cancer in our world is so terrible. And Father, I bring a name before you this morning that not many here will know, a 10-year-old girl named Charlie, Father. And we ask that as she had surgery yesterday to remove that tumor from her brain, Father, that you will be with her and her family. And Father, that you will gather your gifting angels around her to bring them healing and comfort. Father, we have so many things that are happening in our community, in the communities around our country, and we ask that you bring calm to our nation as you only you can, Father. And Father, we pray for our local police officer that was struck. And Father, we're grateful that he has served us at this church on 19 different occasions, Father, to bring protection to us. And Father, we pray fervently for his recovery. We ask for healing upon him, Father. And we know that that will come from you if it is your will. Father, be with us this morning as we gather together and as we lift our voices to you, Father, and we hear your messages preached from this building again this morning. We're thankful for you, and we're thankful for the life of Jesus and the sacrifice that he made so that all of us in this room and around the world might have an opportunity to gather in front of your throne one day. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I might ask if everyone would kind of move into the center so the singing would sound better. Now, we would normally ask if we were spread out, but we really tried to get spread out today. So, sing out, and the singing will sound good. We're glad to be able to do that this morning. We're doing things a little bit different order. We're going to have a couple of songs, then we'll have our sermon following that, and then we'll do communion, gather around the Lord's table, following our sermon before we're dismissed this morning. A wonderful Savior. We're going to sing verses 1, 3, and 4 of this song.
A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord, a wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock where rivers of pleasure I see. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. With numberless blessings each moment he crowns and filled with his fullness divine. I sing in my rapture, oh, glory to God, for such such a redeemer as mine. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand. When clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. And covers me there with his hand.
Our next song will be Restore My Soul. We'll sing all three verses of this song as well.
Restore my spirit, Lord, I need restored. My heart is weary, please help me, dear Lord. I stand in need of more strength from your word. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. Revive the fire, Lord, deep in my soul. Stir my desire to work in your fold. Light in my heart, dear God, your zeal grown cold. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul. Renew my courage, Lord, in needs restored. My cup is empty, refill it, dear Lord. Replace all doubts and fear with faith so bold. Renew my love, rebuild my faith, oh, restore my soul.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Church family, welcome home. I know we are all well aware of just how long it's been since we've been able to actually assemble in this very building. It's been far too long. These walls haven't heard your beautiful voices in far too long. We haven't been able to celebrate the Lord's Supper together in far too long. I've been preaching to a screen for far too long. Doing things virtually was good, but there's nothing quite like being at home. Anyone that has family far away knows that FaceTime is a real blessing. It's a really good thing, but it is so terribly inferior to actually being in the physical presence with the ones you love. Now, I understand this may not be exactly the homecoming we were hoping for, right? We unfortunately are having to social distance and do a few things just a little bit differently. But despite any of these awkward and inconvenient things, isn't it so great to be back where we belong? As we just saw in our video, the idea of coming home is a really important thing, not just for us, but for different people throughout history and throughout Scripture. Perhaps one of the main things we think of when we contemplate this idea of returning home is the Israelites returning home from exile. Scripture tells us that it was because of Israel's sins of idolatry and rebellion against God that the Lord sent the Babylonians to conquer them and take them from their home. In a flash, all the normal, everyday aspects of life had changed. Their jobs ended. They lost their homes, and they even lost their normal weekly religious services. It sounds kind of familiar, doesn't it? But after that time in captivity was up, about 70 years, it was finally time for them to return home. Like I said, this idea of returning is something that's found all throughout Scripture. And what is so interesting about this idea is that when the Bible talks about someone or a group of people returning home, it usually has a double meaning. It is referring to both people physically returning home, obviously, but also returning spiritually home as well. Isn't that interesting? So to illustrate this in terms of Israel coming home from exile, the book of Ezra describes this double physical spiritual returning. There were exiles coming back to the land of Canaan, but it was also a time of great spiritual renewal and that the altar and temple were being rebuilt. Passover was beginning to be celebrated again. And Ezra spent a lot of time preaching and teaching the law of the Lord again. It was a physical return home, but maybe more than that, it was a spiritual return home as well. Are there any other stories that you can think of from Scripture that talk about someone returning home both in a physical sense and in a spiritual sense? Perhaps a prodigal son, maybe? Here again is an account of someone separated from their home only to return in a physical and spiritual way. Today, you and I are returning to worship. We're returning to worship services at sunset after being gone for a considerable amount of time, much longer than I think any of us would have thought when this whole thing started. Maybe we should see today not only as a physical return to the building, but maybe also a spiritual return to the Lord. Now, obviously, there are some differences between what has happened with us in the last months and the account of Israel being exiled in the prodigal son parable. I don't necessarily think it was because of our idolatry that brought the coronavirus to Springfield, Missouri. It wasn't because we demanded our inheritance and went away to the far country to live frivolously that we are now returning home. But could it be that we could use this opportunity presented before us, this time of physical returning, to also look deeply at it in a spiritual sense? We could use it as an opportunity to look deeply at our spiritual lives and maybe find that we too need to return in a spiritual way. I don't know how many can relate to me on this. Maybe a few here. Maybe everyone. I don't know. But I think my separation from the church in the last couple months have made me go through somewhat of a dry season, spiritually speaking. Not being around my brothers and sisters has, to be honest with you, made my prayer life a little shallower. My time with the Lord seems to be more hurried. And I didn't really notice this until I was actually able to attend a worship service a couple weeks ago when we were in Texas visiting some family. I was sitting there, even socially distanced from other people, looked very similar to this service we're having together. But I remember getting chills from the singing and was deeply engaged with every part of the service, almost like never before. And I remember feeling upset that it had to end. I finally realized that this is what was missing. It was the regular assembly of all of you that so deeply impacts me. I said this in one of our videos the other day, but after that worship service in Texas, the song leader came up to me. And he said, "Hey, Phillip, good job this morning. And I was confused. I didn't know what he was talking about. I said, well, I wasn't preaching, didn't have any part of the service, so what are you talking about? And he said, well, I heard you singing today. I guess I was so excited, just so thrilled to be in the presence of other Christians for the first time in a long time, that I was singing out almost like never before. Maybe you can relate to me today, and that the last couple of months have been a drier season for you, spiritually speaking. I know I'm not alone because another minister on staff told me that it's been similar for him as well. Maybe your prayer life has waned. Maybe your Bible reading is much more sporadic. Maybe you started off prioritizing some of our virtual services, but they quickly became more and more difficult to find time for. This isn't a guilt or judgment thing on you. This is me talking to myself, as I think all of us collectively may be feeling some of these common feelings. So how can we today return home? We are returning physically today, but maybe more importantly than that, how can we return spiritually today? How can today mark the start of a spiritual renewal in all of our lives? Let's find out in Luke chapter 15, if you have a Bible with you. Luke 15. Let's read this familiar story together. In Luke chapter 15, verses 11, and we'll go down to verse 20 for now. And he said, there was a man who had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me. And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate. And no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. Let's stop there for a moment. As we look at a guide for returning home, let's look at four things this young man did to spiritually return home to his father. It's this double meaning. He's physically returning home, but he's also spiritually returning home. Luke tells us that this younger son had the audacity to demand his inheritance from his father. Now, most of the time, people don't get their inheritance from their parents until they have passed away. So this guy essentially comes in and he says, Dad, I wish you were dead, so why don't you go ahead and give me my money and give it to me now? As disrespectful as this would be in our culture, surely this was totally dishonorable in the culture that it was originally written in. But after going to a faraway country and spending everything he had, he began to realize what he had done. And this is the moment he began to return. Here's the first thing. The moment he began to return happened when he began to notice his hunger. In verses 14 through 16, he begins to feel himself. He begins to notice his hunger. Luke tells us this young man took the lowly job of being a pig feeder and was so hungry that he actually became envious of the pigs he was feeding because they got to eat. It was in that moment that his return to the Father began. He took notice of how empty he felt apart from his home. I think this is also our first step in returning spiritually to our Father. We too have to take notice of our hunger. And maybe more than that, take notice of what we have been being sustained by. Jesus tells us that in John 4:14, that the nourishment that he gives us is something that truly satisfies. It's something that truly fills us. The bread he gives us makes us never hunger again. The water he gives us quenches our thirst for all of eternity. the things that he gives us to sustain ourselves is something that truly satisfies our every longing. Now, the tragedy is that all of us try to fill this hunger in many different ways when we first feel it. We turn to our entertainment or our activities or our jobs, and you name it, you know these things. Just anything to fill the void that we feel increasingly growing inside of us. But at the end of the day, you and I, and all of humanity for that matter, can only be satisfied with the bread that Jesus offers us, which is the fellowship that we have with him. So if you feel a little far from the Father this morning and you need to come back closer to him, first notice your hunger. Notice what you are being sustained by and try to set aside all those other things that promise full stomachs, but don't deliver. Let's look at the next step in our guide to returning home. The prodigal son began to return home when he remembered how good his father's house was. Verse 17, he remembered how good his father's house was. The text says that he came to himself and he remembered the abundance of food and joy that existed in his father's household. Now, if he had to remember how good it was, that means at some point he had forgotten how good it had been. Maybe he saw his sonship as kind of a burden as it came with all of these different responsibilities, so he left. But in leaving, he gradually forgot more and more about how wonderful his father's house actually was. Maybe today you can relate to this aspect of leaving and then returning. Maybe some of us get caught up in seeing our faith as a bunch of rules to follow and hoops to jump through, and have forgotten how wonderful it really is to be in the Lord's family. Maybe for some of us to return closer to the Lord, we simply need to remember. We need to remember what it means and how great of a privilege it is to be in Christ. Can you remember a time in your life when you were really at your best, spiritually speaking? I mean, maybe it was after a particularly great worship service or a visit with a friend or something like that, but you remember being totally on fire. You felt so good. You had that peace that surpasses understanding inside of you. You felt an intimacy with God like you had hardly felt before. I remember when Elena and I were in college, our spring breaks were different one year because she was student teaching, so I had a week at our little apartment with pretty much nothing to do. So I decided to spend those 5 days reading scripture. Now, I'm sure I watched some TV and did some other things, but I had never before that time read that amount of scripture in such a short amount of time. But what happened to me that week really changed me in a lot of ways. I remember riding a spiritual wave for months after that short spurt of reading. I was more at peace. I felt much closer to the Lord and in tune with his will for my life. It was the best I had felt in a long, long time. And I say that because I bet there are times that you've tasted how good the Lord is, how good it was to be close to him. Maybe if we've been experiencing some time further away from him than we'd like to be, we should remember those times when we felt truly close to him. And this has been true of my own life. I constantly go back to that 1 week that I spent reading and praying and being with the Lord. And I remember thinking, I need to get back on track because I remember how good that felt. And maybe we all need to remember how good our Father's house is. The psalmist says this beautifully in Psalm 84:10. He says, "For a day in your courts is better than 1,000 elsewhere. I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness." To spiritually return, we need to remember the goodness of what we are returning to. Let's look at how else this young man returned home. In verses 18 and 19, he begins to rehearse this big speech that he plans on giving. And by the way, I think this is just kind of shows the humanity of Scripture here, because haven't we all done this? Haven't we all rehearsed some things that we were going to say just exactly? Maybe there was a meeting with your boss and you knew you were going to say just these exact words to him. Maybe you're going to ask out this girl and you had to say exactly the right thing and wait for the precisely right moment. Well, this is exactly what's going on here. This prodigal son is thinking out what he will say when he returns home. And he says, "I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.'" Here's what I think we should learn from this. He humbled himself. To spiritually return home, the prodigal son humbled himself. It is so difficult admitting when we're wrong, isn't it? Or when we've been doing some things that we shouldn't have been doing. Or to admit that maybe there's some things we should have been doing that we hadn't been doing. But this is such a crucial piece for our guide to return home. Like this son, we have to be willing to say that we can't make it on our own and we need to return back to the Father. James reminds us in James 4:6 that God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. In other words, there is no returning back to the Father when there is pride in the way. Grace is extended to us when we can humble ourselves before God. Has anyone ever genuinely apologized to you when they were prideful? Probably not. That's impossible. And if they did, it probably sounded something like, "I'm sorry that you're so stubborn," or "I'm sorry, but," or something like that. But real reconciliation happens when someone says, "I know that things have been one way, but I want to change to make them better." This is what the prodigal son did, and this is what we will need to do as well to return home. Let's look at one more way he returned home. Number four, and most obviously, but maybe most importantly, the beginning of verse 20 says that he arose and came to his father. In other words, he actually turned around and took that first step back home. Guides are good, aren't they? Maps are good. I don't know how many places I'd be able to get with Google Maps in my pocket, but they only work if they are actually followed. If they're actually put into practice. All his noticing is hunger and remembering his father and the signs of humility were useless if he didn't decide to pack up and start walking back. And for us to spiritually return home, it actually takes us picking up our feet and taking active steps back. We can philosophize and theologize, and spend a lot of time talking about the ways that maybe we should return home and the tactics we can use to return home. But perhaps the most powerful thing we can do to actually do so is start walking back. Maybe for you that means cutting out some things that have pulled you from the Lord in the first place. Maybe it means reprioritizing your days so that you can spend more time with God again. Maybe it means coming to church or Bible classes again, although we're not having Bible classes just yet, but you get the idea. To return home, we have to take action and determine what is going to change for us to do so. Now, how can we be expected to be received when we return home? You probably know how this story ends, don't you? But let's read it together. The last part of verse 20 through verse 24. "But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to celebrate." As this prodigal son returned home, he went into that scripted speech that he had so carefully crafted, that he had so carefully prepared. But notice that he doesn't even get through the whole thing. Go back to where he started coming up with his speech. And as he comes home, it's like the father cuts him off almost in verse 22, and he essentially says, "Listen, none of that really matters. All that matters is that you are home. You're back where you belong." Some here today might picture God as this grumpy old man sort of crossing his arms and kind of scoffs at us and just tolerates us. He's completely unhappy with everything we do. But Jesus says that picture couldn't be farther from the truth, particularly when a child of his decides to come home. He runs to meet us. He leaps and shouts with joy as he goes. So I guess the only question left to ask for us today is, have you wandered away from the Father today? Do you need to return home? Someone here today might feel like they are miles and miles off, and in fact, and never really had a relationship with their Creator. Scripture says that you can come home and be baptized into Christ to become a full-fledged member of the heavenly family. The option is absolutely available for you today. Maybe you've been in a relationship with the Father like this prodigal son, but for whatever reason, maybe even kind of by accident, you've slowly drifted further and further away from Him. Today could also be a great day to return home. But maybe all of us, no matter how near or far from home we are today, should use today as an opportunity not just to return to the church building, as exciting and as joyful of an event this is, but maybe today should mark the start of a spiritual renewal in our lives as we spiritually return home to the Father. If there's anything we can do for you today, we'd love to serve you in whatever way we can as we stand and sing together.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory. Blaze, Spirit, blaze. Set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, flow. Flood the nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may enter brightness, search me, try me, consume all my darkness, shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory, bless, Spirit, bless. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. As we gaze on your kingly brightness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing, glory to glory, mirrored here, may our light tell your story, shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine, fill this land with the Father's glory, bless, Spirit, bless, set our hearts on fire. Flow, river, with grace and mercy set forth your word, Lord, and let there be light.
Please be seated. To help prepare our minds for the Lord's Supper, we will sing 10,000 Angels. We want to sing all four verses and then the chorus following the fourth verse only. So all four verses and then the chorus.
They bound the hands of Jesus in the garden where he prayed. They led him through the streets in shame. They spat upon the Savior, so pure and free from sin. They said, crucify him, he's to blame. Upon his precious head, they placed a crown of thorns. They laughed and said, behold the king. They struck him and they cursed him and mocked his holy name. All alone he suffered everything. When they nailed him to the cross, his mother stood nearby. He said, woman, behold my son. He cried, I thirst for water, but they gave him none to drink. Then the sinful work of man was done. To the howling mob he yielded. He did not for mercy cry. The cross of shame he took alone. And when he cried, it's finished, he gave himself to die. Salvation's wondrous plan was done. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died alone for you and me.
Before we enter into our communion portion of the service, I want to give a little tutorial on the cups in case you're not used to these portable communion cups. Hopefully you got one when you came in. If you didn't, raise your hand right now and the ushers will just bring you one. I think everybody got one as they came in. The very top, you want to peel back just that very first layer. That's going to be the bread. And then underneath that is going to be the cup. So you'll pull one off and then pull the other one off. If you are unable to get these open, I know they're a little tricky. We do have some trays that our ushers can bring you. One half of that tray has the bread. The other half has the vine. We won't pass those, of course, but we will hand you the tray. Just take one of each. And then as we do our prayers, you can partake of that. So if you're struggling with getting that open, then just let them know, raise your hand, and they'll bring you those trays. We want to go ahead and enter into our communion service now. be reading a scripture. It'll be Romans 5, 6 through 11. Romans 5, 6 through 11. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Let's pray for the vine. Father, as we pause during this communion service, we are eternally grateful for this. And we know that as we gather here this morning for the first time in a long time, that we commune together as a fellowship, and we are so grateful for this opportunity to be with you today and commune with you, Father. We are so grateful for that. And we know we've been doing that at home as well, but just to be here among family again is wonderful, and we thank you for that. We do this in honor of your Son, as we know that he took our sins to the cross. He bore that burden for us. We are so grateful for it, Father. And right now, let us clear our minds and think on that, and help us understand what that means to each and every one of us, Father. We just are so thankful for the life that he led and what he taught us, and also the death on the cross that gives us reconciliation to you. It's through your Son, Jesus, I pray. Amen. Let's pray for the vine. Almighty Father, we know that it is through your Son's blood that we find this reconciliation, that we are able to be your children, and we are so thankful that his blood was shed for us, Father. We know that it shields us from the wrath that we deserve, and we are so thankful that he did this for us. And as we partake of this, Father, I pray that you see us do so. Know that we believe in that wholeheartedly, that his blood saves us from our sins. We're so thankful for the plan that you put in place and for sending him to the cross for us. We love him so much. It's through your Son, Jesus, I pray. Amen. This concludes the communion portion of our worship. Just hang on to these cups. We're going to dismiss here soon, and you can take those with you. And there's some trash cans by the table where you pick them up, and you can just drop those in the trash can if you leave, as you leave. And David will have a few more instructions after this.
Well, I don't know about you, but that felt good to be able to be to be together again, to once again be able to lift our voices in song. I even heard Robbie Davis. Can you imagine that? I have a pair of old slippers at home. My kids have bought me numerous new pairs of slippers. And those new ones are still in the closet, still in the box. And much to their chagrin, every winter, I pull out those old, raunchy-looking slippers and put them on again because they feel good. They're part of me. And that's kind of the way it feels this morning. Like it's winter again, and I get to put on the most comfortable pair of slippers I've ever had. And it feels so good to see each one of you, to see your smiling faces, even if I have to guess who you are behind your mask. It is so wonderful to see you all, and we welcome you all here today, even if it is only a third of you. And we look forward to next Sunday when we get to join together again. I only have one announcement to make before dismissal instructions, and that is we are pleased to be able to announce that we have a new lady who wants to be place membership here. She is not at this service, nor will she be at second service. She will be at the 5 o'clock group. Her name is Anna Lee Phillips. She's the sister of Ethel Wilhelm, and she'll be here at 5 o'clock. But when we all finally get to meet together, search her out, look for her picture on the board so that you can find her and make her feel welcome. Make her feel part of this awesome family that we have here at Sunset. Now, as far as dismissing is concerned, as Brian made reference to, if you will take your communion cup with you as you exit, there are trash cans at the exits. And as far as exiting, the people in the chair group for this wing, if you'll exit through that door, the people in this chair group, if you'll exit through that back door, and then the people in the pews, so an usher will come and begin at the back and designate your row to be able to exit, and we'll work our way to the front. It's inconvenient, I know. It's not the way that we would like for it to be, but to practice social distancing and to be in compliance with CDC guidelines, this is the way it is. As far as visiting, the parking lot is open. But please exit quickly so that we can clean the building for the next group and so that we can also prepare for the next service. If you brought your contribution with you this morning, you can also hand that as you exit through the doorways. And Don Johnson will be at that door. Bruce will be at that door, and the two ushers will be there. So as we exit, beginning at the back, an usher will designate your row to leave, and then we can exit the building and bring this worship service to a conclusion. I don't know about you, I'll say it again, this felt good to be able to be with each other once again and to see each other. So much of our worship service is praising God, but a very, very strong element is being together. Would you pray with me, please? Holy Father, it has been a long time since we have been able to join together in communion to celebrate and acknowledge the sacrifice that was made for each one of us. We have done it independently at our homes, but it is so much more meaningful, Father, to do it here together. And we give you thanks, Father, that you have watched over and protected each one of us through the last 12 or so weeks, that none of us has fallen victim to the virus, that to our knowledge, we have not lost anyone in death. And we give you thanks, Father, for your protection during this period. We ask for your guidance, Father, as we continue to walk through this unusual time. And we just pray that you would give us the wisdom that we need and the patience that we need to endure, because we look forward to that day when we can all join together collectively without fear of and concern about contracting the virus. But until that time, Father, we just ask for your presence in our lives, not only physically, but more so spiritually, that we can stay close to you, be drawn closer to you through all circumstances. Father, we pray for peace. We pray for peace among the nations. We pray for peace within our own nation, which seems to be in a period of unrest. Help us all, Father, to listen more than we speak, to put others ahead of ourselves, to think before we act, and to remember our Lord and our Savior and the sacrifice that he made for each and every one of us. We also pray for peace, Father, within our own personal lives. We pray for those who are lonely because of loss of loved ones. We pray for those who have had surgery recently and ask for your healing hand upon them. For those that are undergoing tests or therapy, we ask that you would be with the doctors and nurses that treat them, that the test and the therapy might be successful. Father, go with us this day. Help us to be more like your Son. Help us, Father, to forgive others as we would ask that you forgive us. Thank you, Father, for this hour that we've had together. We look forward to another opportunity a week from today. But in the meantime, Father, take care of us, forgive us, and thank you for your Son. Thank you so much for your Son and the sacrifice that he made. But most of all, we thank you for the empty tomb that gives us the assurance of a home with you in the end. For it's through his holy name that we pray. Amen.